Imagine a town where there are no small joints, just small stoners, where Kush is a girl's best friend, and law-breaking is the new liberty. It's the Hollywood Hemptress Hour, hosted by your honey blonde Hemptress, Terry Joyce. Yeah!
Have you ever had a friend unfriend request you on Facebook? I have. It happened about 6 months ago, and the argument that we had was about guns and marijuana. You see, this was a person that I knew from a long time ago, and he found me on Facebook, and because my profile was so heavily, you know, had marijuana symbols on it, obviously I was doing the show, he would, you know, say things like, "Hey, Terry, you know, I can come over, we can smoke some bud and get some, we can get high and maybe I can see you naked," you know? And I usually like avoid these kinds of happenings, you know? I mean, I thought he was a nice guy, but whatever. I thought because he was doing that to me, I thought he was like pro-marijuana friendly. So at some point, he says, "Hey, Terry, would you check out my YouTube video? I'd really like to get your opinion and get some advice about my YouTube videos." Well, I did listen to his YouTube videos, and his YouTube videos were about guns. They're about like what kind of guns were good, how to maintain your guns. And then he would also do some shows that were about like maybe what was going on with the government, with Occupy, things like this. And I had made a YouTube video, and I said, "I'd really like you to see my YouTube video." And he was like, "Oh, no." He writes me back. He goes, "Terry, I can't, like, support your cause. I just do not support marijuana. My dad was in the military, and he smoked a lot of weed. He became super lazy, and then he killed himself with a gun." And first of all, I felt a little bit of deception because here was this guy that was trying to seduce me with marijuana. Like, he wanted to see me. It was okay to offer marijuana to see me naked. Like, that wasn't an issue for him. You know, like, kind of like, and it really kind of made me angry that I was cheapened, like I was a coke whore or something. So then, but that aside, because, you know, I put that on the back burner for a moment, I came back at him and I said, "You know, I'm sorry to hear that your dad got so depressed that he committed suicide. You know, oftentimes people who are using pharmaceutical drugs, they oftentimes, you know, the side effects is suicide. But there's rarely a rate where somebody actually commits suicide from smoking marijuana. I mean, you don't see somebody like, you know, taking a really big bong hit and go, 'Wow, that was great. I think I'm going to kill myself now.' But that doesn't really like happen." So we ended up getting into a real heated discussion about it, and eventually I said, you know, it came out to where I said, "You know what, it wasn't weed that killed your dad, because weed's never killed anybody in the human history of mankind." I said, "It was guns. Guns is the problem. Guns is what kills us."
MedMan Passion is the mobile medical cannabis delivery service for Tri-Cities, Washington. MedMan Passion features over 25 strains of medical cannabis and mini edibles to choose from, like pineapple and raspberry suckers, chocolate brownies, along with chocolate blueberry and banana muffins, and lemon poppy, a patient favorite. MedMan Passion also carries lines of safe, potent hashes, keef, hash oil, vanilla drops, including their famous Dragon Drop tinctures. They also have cooking oils full of THC and CBDs for your cooking pleasure. All of their products are natural and butane-free. Check out MedMan Passion at www.medmanpassion.com or give us a call at 509-551-5105. MedMan Passion Legal Cannabis Delivery. Open 5 days a week from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Friday. Saturdays by appointment only. staying tuned. This is Hollywood Hemptress Hour. Online right now through Skype, we have DJ Kuti to give us the Compassion Flower Report. Welcome to the show, DJ.
Hi, thanks for having me. Good to be here with you.
It's good to see you.
Yeah, it's good to be seen.
So what's going on in LA right now?
Well, I thought what I would let all of our audience know about is one of the blog posts we put up recently was about a dispensary operator here in LA by the name of Viana Haju. And if people go to our blog, Cannabis Patient Voice, they can click over to it from our website, cannabissaveslives.org. The title of the blog post is Vindictive Prosecution versus Viana Haju. Mm-hmm. And the reason I entitled it that way is I've been going to court with Viana now for 3.5 years on local charges from the LA District Attorney's Office, who raided her for doing what hundreds of collectives are doing throughout the city. And of course, whenever they call her case up, it's always the people versus Viana Haju. And I don't see the people there being represented. The only thing I see being representative there is a very vindictive prosecution who's trying to take her down. I can talk a little bit more about her case. I don't know if you have any specific questions you'd like me to address.
Well, I know like her case you've been working on it, and we've also talked about her on the show previously. One thing that I would like to do is discuss, perhaps let the viewers know about the fundraiser that we have going on for her and her legal defense coming up very soon.
Right. Well, as people can know, like I said, if they read the blog, they'll see the way the police treated her, what they did to her daughter, what they did to her home, how they've wrecked this woman's life. And as you could imagine, when you have to pay an attorney for 3.5 years for the prosecution dragging out this case, they've switched prosecutors, like I think 5 times, and just found every reason to drag this out for no other reason than just to bankrupt this woman. And so, yeah, she definitely needs some help with her legal expenses and, other medical needs that she has had as a result of this. And so, yeah, you and I have teamed up to do a show here in the future. I don't know if there's a solid date on that.
Actually, I know I haven't discussed this with you, but there is, we now do have an option to do one of the 4 Saturdays in March at the Cannabis Cafe in Portland, Oregon.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And so that's a way that people can, we'll be able to donate in the future at an event. But if people want to donate right now, if they go to our blog and read the story, they can look in that side margin on our blog, and there's a donate button specifically for the Viana Haju Legal Defense Fund. So I'm hoping people will take a look at that, go to cannabissaveslives.org, click over to our blog, read the story, make a donation, sign up for our Twitter at Pan for Compassion, and get involved.
Great. Thank you so much for calling in today, being on the show, and giving us the information about her court case and how our viewers can stay tuned and participate either by helping us out with funding, tweeting, letting other people know about what's going on, and we will keep everyone posted. And we'll be right back to more Hollywood Hemptress Hour. Stay tuned. In August of 2009, Viana Haju lost her home, her health, and her livelihood for doing what many people in California are doing right now. She was the director of a medical marijuana dispensary. Her collective was raided by the LAPD in a SWAT-style manner. She and her employees were held by gunpoint. They were talked to in a derogatory, abusive manner, and they even threatened to shoot her animals. What they found and what they confiscated was $120 and 4 pounds of dried cannabis leaves. Let's listen to what happened to Viana Haju right now in her own words.
With the guns drawn, there were a lot of cops. They called me names. He called me, he said, "Get the fuck out of here, bitch." I told him that I need to put my dogs away. I had two small dogs. And he said, I don't give a fuck. I'll shoot them. And in the dispensary was me, my security guard, our security guard, and a patient. The patient got very scared, and he started throwing up. They drug us out outside of the dispensary, and they handcuff us, and they search the place, and they find in the drawer $120 and less than a pound of medicine in the jars. He was a very, very bad talking to me, called me names, and told me he went to one of the volunteer house and put everybody on the floor, what I heard later on, and put the shotgun to their heads like they did to my daughter. And I told that if they did go to my apartment to get the key, so because I have my daughter, which is it's a bipolar schizophrenic, and she's suicidal. And he didn't care. He said, I don't care. And
during the raid, Viana began to feel dizzy and faint, and she asked the LAPD for her blood pressure medication. They took the medication out of her purse and sat it in front of her, but never gave her a pill. Later on that evening, she was booked, and the police asked her to sign a release, what she thought was a release for her possessions. She was faint, she was dizzy, she wasn't feeling well. Later on, she found out that she signed a confession admitting her guilt of having 50 pounds of marijuana, and her bail was set at $50,000. Later that evening, Viana suffered a stroke.
Medication, because I have a very bad headache and my blood pressure was up, and they took the medication out of my purse, and they put it in front of me. I was handcuffed and sit on the couch. They put it in front of me on the table and never give it to me. A couple hours later, when they brought me to the station, I told the commander in charge there that I have a very bad headache and they didn't give me my medication. I have the medication. This one told them to book me and then bring me to the jail in Van Nuys because they don't have nurse on staff. And while they were booking me, they made me sign a few pieces of papers, which I didn't have my glasses, they didn't let me read. They told me that it's for my possessions. They took all my possessions from me, and I signed. To find out later in the court that they put a piece of paper which was said was a confession that I signed it, that I confessed to whatever they thought I did.
Most medical marijuana dispensaries are raided by the federal government. The reason why this happens is because the federal government does not recognize state law. Marijuana is a class one drug, therefore it's federally illegal. In Viana Haju's case, her dispensary was raided by the LAPD. Viana had all the correct documentation, she had paid her business license and her taxes, and yet she was still raided by her own state police. Why do we pay taxes for this injustice?
In my franchise, the tax board, it states Medical Marijuana Dispensary Collective. So if I didn't lie to you, and even today, you go to them and you have to pay extra, because if you ask you are you selling medical marijuana? If we are illegal to sell medical marijuana, why you ask me to pay you money for that?
Right.
You should said no. You cannot open this.
You can open this.
You cannot open this. This is.
But no, they said no. You have.
LA City Councilman Jose Huizar campaigns that the reason why we need to shut down the medical marijuana dispensaries is because they're profiteers making over $100,000 a month. Like every medical marijuana dispensary owner is Pablo Escobar. This is not true. The real Pablo Escobar is something much more sinister. It's a corporation called Big Pharma. Viana Haju is nothing like that.
What is your mansion? What is your car? What is your money? I said, what money? What are you talking about? And he said, oh, you know what I'm talking about. I said, no, I don't know what you're talking about. Because I don't have mansion. I don't have cars. I was driving a Honda Civic, and I was living in an apartment with my daughter. And I had a salary of $2,200 a month, and they paid me my medical insurance. That's what I got from running managing a legal dispensary. We were not making money. It was a non-profit organization. We did not make money off of this.
A lot of people wonder why Viana won't just take a plea and get it over with. But Viana has done nothing wrong, and she will not lie in a court of law.
Well, I should not take a plea, because if I take a plea, I would be a liar. I never lied in my life. And if I raise my hand in the court and I say that I will say the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and help me God, if I take the plea, I will be a liar.
Viana has lost her health, her home, and her ability to be employed is non-existent.
The affair, I never got anything back from them. It cost me my health, my apartment, I got evicted. The lawyer cost me over $25,000. And right now, I really need your help. And I appreciate it if you guys can help me out to fight this system. This system is wrong. We need to fight this. Please help me to fight this system.
As an American citizen, I am concerned about the militarization of our police. Just recently, the ACLU is doing an investigation on our police force. They want to find out why SWAT teams are being deployed, how much money is being used, whether or not anybody's injured. The Homeland Security has just ordered 26 million rounds of ammo, which equates to 12.6 billion bullets, which means that they can shoot every American and immigrant with 5 bullets. Why is this happening when our Second Amendment rights are in question? Just recently in 2011, there was some sort of militarized police that nobody could identify that seemed to come out of Disneyland in Anaheim. And some people believe that Disneyland is the happiest place on earth. On the police car, there are the words protect and serve. But who are they protecting? And what do they serve? It's just like a euphemism, an advertisement, something that we've been conditioned with. Like good to the last drop. Is it really good to the last drop? Well, quite frankly, it's just the last drop. It may be good or it may not be. Have it your way. I don't know about you, but every time I go to Burger King and ask for a cider ranch dressing, they say no. It takes a licking, but it keeps on ticking. Well, that one may be true because it takes a good lick to make me tick. But here's one for you. Nothing says oppression like a gun in their face. Now, maybe if we add some snappy music and some good visuals, people will begin to believe that one too.
We'll be right back. Hollywood Hemptress Hour presents Ganja-palooza, the 420 stand-up comedy show, Saturday, April 20th at the M Hotel Tuscany Grill and Lounge in Richland, Washington. Come see the Hollywood Hemptress herself, Terry Joyce, as she celebrates the legalization of cannabis in Colorado and Washington states with an all-star stand-up comedy show and dance party. Joining Terry for this night of laughs is comedian Ngayo Bilum from MTV and Comedy Central, along with Jay London from Last Comic Standing and The Tonight Show, and a special appearance of the ever-vigilant Sergeant Detective Harry Palmer Jr. retired for two shows, 6:30 and 9 p.m. Then stay and party with two of L.A.'s fastest rising reggae bands, White Glove and Amity Flow. Don't miss this landmark event, Washington State's legalized first 420 celebration. Tickets are on sale now at www.ganjapalooza.com. So tell your friends and come join the palooza Saturday, April 20th at the M Hotel Tuscany Grill and Lounge in Richland, Washington. You'll want to be there when we make 420 history.
Staying tuned to Hollywood Hemptress Hour. Right now we have comedian, actress Amy Milstein here, who is also, I did get it right, who is, she has been suffering from MS since 1990. And I'd like to also welcome you to the show.
Thank you. Nice to be here. Yes, I was diagnosed in 1990. I had my first symptom. It was in December of 1983. It was my freshman year of college, so now you know how old I am. But yeah, I woke up and I was like, wow, half my body is numb. That's really weird. I will go to class now and pretend this is not going on. And it would go away and come back. So I have remitting, relapsing MS. It would go away, it would come back. I would have numbness, I would have dizziness. I would have tingling, never pain, which is a good thing. But I was diagnosed in 1990. And I knew it was serious when I saw how much it cost to go into an MRI machine, because back then MRIs were not as common as they are now. And I was diagnosed, they had medication for it at the time that was experimental, and I chose not to go on it because I just didn't want to deal with it. You had to be on a waiting list to get it, and I just wanted to just deny that I had the MS and pretend that I didn't have it and make it go away. Which worked for a long time, actually.
It's funny how that, I think, kind of how that works.
Yeah, isn't it great?
It's like how your mind can, I don't have it, I'm fine.
I know, I'm feeling all tingly, but I'm going to pretend I don't. And that worked for as long as it could. This was back in New York and New Jersey, where I grew up. When I moved out here, it was about 11 years ago, I felt myself getting sick again. Mm-hmm. And I had a neurologist out. I didn't even have a neurologist out here. But I was like, oh no, I'm going to let this go away. I'm not dealing with this. And I had a very bad episode where I was so dizzy that I almost drove off the road. I couldn't walk straight. It was bad. It was the worst one I've ever had. So we found a doctor out here, and the doctor put me on my medication that I take now, which is called Avonex, which is an intramuscular injection that you take once a week. The side effects are horrible.
What are some of the side effects that you go through?
They call it flu-like symptoms, chills and body aches. But when you first start taking this medicine, first of all, you have to give yourself a shot. And the needle is like this big. It's big. So you have to shoot yourself in the thigh with it. And then chills, yeah, but it's like I would be wearing sweatsuit and a blanket and a hat in front of the fireplace going like this and just not being able to get warm.
And does this happen like every week when you do it, or is it
okay? That was in the beginning.
Okay.
It is now to the point where I just take my shot, I take a couple of Advil, I go to bed, I feel fine in the morning. If I forget to take the Advil, sometimes I'll wake up in the middle of the night going, oh my gosh, it's so cold in here. Oh, I forgot to take Advil. So chills, body aches, in the beginning, you know, you were just wasted for the half of the next day, you know, and I had two little kids, and it was hard to not be able to do things, not be able to get out of bed.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's almost like
And I for some reason, I was like equating to your menstrual cycle. Like every once a month, you have to like be, and then you have like four times of something on top of that. And yeah, that's just overwhelming. I don't even know how you do it. The one I do want to ask you: have you ever looked into using medical marijuana for MS, or have you been heard about it?
I have heard about it. I have a friend who has a card, and I said, "How did you get that?" She said, "Oh, I have something." I'm like, "Oh, I have MS," and she goes, "Oh, that'll get you a card."
Yeah.
And I was like, oh,
wow. It's so funny. People go, I have cancer. Yay, I can smoke marijuana.
Wow, yay.
It's like candy, but it's not quite like
No, not exactly. So I have not pursued it, though. Uh-huh. I mean, I have been taking this medicine. It is very expensive, but I do have insurance for it. But if I didn't, it would be $1,000 a month just for the medicine. So I don't know what the medical marijuana would do as far as preventing.
Well, there's a woman, I know that there's some people that are using it. I personally, I need to actually study up on all the different things that it might affect. I know that Montel Williams is a big advocate for, he has MS and he also smokes marijuana for it. And says that it helps him be able to like function and, you know, the pain that he's going through, whatever, is like really relieving. A lot of people feel
Montel
that,
does it.
Yeah, if he does it. A lot of people actually feel that one thing that cannabis does is that it can relieve, and you don't have to smoke it either. You can take it in, you know, pill form or a tincture or there's just a tea if you wanted to. You can eat it. And you can kind of learn like how, what kind of dosage works for you, maybe even what kind of strains, because there are certain strains that do different things.
Right.
Some of them are in indica, which is more of a downer, makes you more relaxed.
Right.
And then there's the sativas, which can make you still really highly functional at the same time. So there is a woman that I would, if you'd be willing to, I'd like to have you back on the show, have her call in. She did Hollywood Hemptress Hour before when it was a radio show, and she's an MS patient. She grows all of her organic foods. She uses cannabis on a daily basis, and she has a complete regimen in treating herself with MS. And so maybe I'm thinking that the conversation might, you know,
well, sure, I'd like to ask her some questions.
Yeah.
You know, my symptoms are very, I've been lucky as far as my symptoms for MS, but it would be wonderful to know that I had more options.
Yeah, okay. And then, you know, and again, like, I would never, like, advocate going off of the medication that you're existing on or anything like that, but I do believe that I feel that as a society, we're a little too quick to use the pharmaceuticals that they're giving us with the side effects that they have. And sometimes you go, well, am I really being cured? Or am I just kind of like treating some part of the symptoms of this disease that I actually really have?
Oh, no one's telling me I'm being cured this medicine that I'm taking.
So, and what else could we do? Like, you know, what else is available to us? You know, what herbs, vitamins, you know, something else that we don't even know, have stumbled on yet. So, and before we go, because we don't have like too much time, but Amy is a improv actress.
I am.
And where do you perform at?
You can catch me at Comedy Sports in Portland, Oregon. You can get tickets on portlandcomedy.com. I also do a murder mystery show called Murder Served Hot, because nothing says fine dining like murder. And one Sunday a month, I'm at Pub Quiz, which is in a McMenamins at the Mission Theater. And you can check out the McMenamins website in Portland and check out Pub Quiz.
And there's also one thing I wanted to bring up, that Amy knows the infamous Rupert Declow that nobody has actually even seen on the show here. Rupert Declow is
but he's so handsome.
Yeah, I know
he's so handsome. He'd crack the camera
and debonair and everything. But you knew Rupert Declow like
way back in the day.
Are we talking like 1983 back in the day?
Or no.
Okay. No.
But 19. When did I buy this house? 1999.
Oh, wow. Okay. 1999.
Yeah. And I was in his first Christmas movie called The Caroling Family. And it was me and my daughter, who was just a little baby. And now she's this big. And yeah, we've done, we love Rupert's work.
We do love Rupert's
work.
We do. And, you know, I heard that you guys are, like, working on a cabaret show, too.
We do.
That we might be live streaming on the Atomic Comedy Network is the goal. So, not might, we are going to be doing it.
That one's called Soho Smooth. It is a comedy cabaret, and it will knock your socks off. Lots of fun.
Well, Amy, I really... Milstein.
Milstein. Get it right.
Do it again.
Jawohl, get it right. There will be problems.
I want to thank you for coming on the show.
Yes, thank you so much. It was a lot of fun.
All right, and we'll see you when you come back.
Thanks.
Great. Thanks. Thank you very much. That was Amy Milstein. We'll be right back.
I have the freedom to think however I want. This is the United States of America, and I think that I'll let Terry do the thinking for me. Terry Joyce puts the probe back in prohibition. Terry Joyce knows more about conspiracy theories than anyone in the United States of America, and that's because she makes up most of them. Terry Joyce can host a show like no one's ever seen, but that's only because no one's ever seen her host a show before. That's why I'm asking you to watch the Hollywood Hemptress Hour with Terry Joyce. And you can trust me because I'm a warlock. Witch's honor.
We have Shiloh Jinglefoot. She is the author of Ganja-licious, The Higher Level of Food. She's here today on the show. Welcome to the show, Shiloh.
Hi, Terry. How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing very well, thanks.
So now you have a wonderful recipe for us today. What is the recipe of the day?
The recipe of a day, I actually called this on my blog. I had it for lunch the other day. It's called The Ass End of an Interracial Sandwich.
The ass end of an interracial sandwich.
Yes.
Wow.
And
I've been there before. No.
I know, right? Me too. We all might have been there. So essentially what it was I had the last piece of bread in the loaf was a piece of white bread. And then I had to get out a piece of white bread. And then I got the next loaf out of the freezer, and it was a piece of wheat bread. And I thought,
is that Hispanic or, you know?
It could be, you know, anything chocolate.
Maybe Asian?
You know?
I don't know.
Whatever, you know, shade of tan you're going for. I don't know. This was 7-grain wheat bread. Anyway. So then I decided to toast both of those and grill them. I put butter on them and I grilled them and I put Colby cheese on one end and pasto, which is the recipe of the week. And I spread that on the sandwich and I put pepperoni and bologna on it and I put it into the toaster oven and kind of like toasted it off so it was all nice and warm and flipped it over and had that with carrots and chips, veggie chips, and it was awesome, let me just tell you. And pasto is so versatile. It's just the best thing that you can do, or I think in many ways that you can do with pot. And
what is pasto?
Pasto is essentially, so when you are going through the extraction process and you put your weed into the oil and you put it into the crock pot and you separate those, and you separate the oil from the weed plant material, I tell you not to strain that. I tell you to actually put that into your food processor and add about a pound of spinach, fresh spinach, and about 3 heads of garlic, about an eighth of a cup of lemon juice, some salt, and then you put a little bit more of that oil that you just extracted You put maybe about a fourth of a cup into the food processor, and you spin that baby up on the food processor. Oh, and sunflower seeds. I forgot. You put sunflower seeds. You could put pine nuts if you, you know, can afford them, but I usually can't. So I put sunflower seeds in them, and you just spin it up in the food processor for about 5 minutes, and it's good to go. And you put it into a container, and you put it in your freezer. I make large portions of this at one time because I make big portions of weed oil. So I can have up to almost a gallon of pot stow from just the plant material of making the oil.
Oh,
and
that's
then the freezer, and you just pull it out of the freezer. It goes through the defrost, and you can put it on toast. You can put it on pasta. You can put it on pizza. I put it on pizza just the other day, and it was so good. You can see pictures of them on my blog because I posted them on the blog and pictures, and it's pretty fun. So pasta is the recipe of the week. It's super easy. Again, you just put your weed into the oil or the butter into a crock pot, and you let it go for 24 hours. I say 24. Everybody else is giving you these 30 minutes, 4 hours, whatever. The longer you cook it, the higher you're going to get.
Oh, well, then let it cook for 24 hours. We can wait, right?
Yeah, right. You can wait. And there's a trick that if you drink a box of wine, you know how they have those bags, those silver bags?
I know all about boxed wine.
Yeah, right. So you cut the bottom part of the box of wine, the straight part, and you put that over your crock pot. And then, because your THC is going to be vaporizing during that cooking process, even on low temperature, it's still going to have some kind of vaporizing happening. So that bag catches that vapor. Uh-huh. And if you just hit that bag every, 30 minutes or so, it's like getting vaped.
It's like having your little vaporizer.
Yes. And it does work. And this is a little trick. And then you'll be making your oil, you separate them, and then you're good to go. And you can put it on anything, everything.
Gosh.
Whatever you desire.
Thank you so much for your recipe. That sounds great. And there's nothing like, cooking your pot so in a crock pot and then having, a little dome from a leftover wine box bag, which, that must be fun just to drink the wine to get the bag in the first place, right? And then you just take it off and inhale. My God. I mean, I just... What a way to make everything be cost effective. So, where's your blog at that the viewers?
You can visit us at ganjalicious.com, and the blog is pretty. It's gathering more and more traffic, so I'm pretty excited. And so you can see these recipes there and pictures for these recipes also on the blog. And you can also visit us on Facebook and Twitter and Flitter. And all those other things. So
great.
And soon we'll have an app for a mobile app for Ganja-licious. So I'll keep you informed.
Thank you so much. Thank you for calling in, Charlotte Jingofook. I want to thank everybody else who's been on the show today. Again, a shout out to Jay Kuti from the Patient Advocacy Network and Amy Mine. I can't believe I forgot. Milshite. Well, what is it, Rubot?
Milstein.
I knew it so well before. Amy Milstein. I want to thank her so much for being on the show, too. We'll see you next time.